Hello, Hairbrained friends, followers, fans all over the world. Good morning, good afternoon, good night, depending on where you are in the globe. Super excited tonight because we're here at Davinez headquarters in New York City with a very, very talented young man, Sal Misseri. Say hi, Sal.
What's going on, Hairbrained?
He just wants to cut hair, so he's already in there. He's got a beautiful model, Mika.
Hi.
And he's going to be doing a beautiful short chic shape for her. That's a hard one to spit out, but I think I just did. So, Sal, you've already started getting your guide in here. Tell us a little bit about the technique and what's happening with the haircut.
So, right now, Mika, we're starting right behind the ear. And I'll pull this guide back out so you can kind of see where we're starting at. But we're going to work just a little bit of graduation through here. What we've kind of noticed earlier when we were taking a look at Mika's hair and I was having a consultation with her is that the back of the head just, you know, her skull structure is a little flatter there. So we want to kind of amp that up a bit, put a little more weight through there. So we also are kind of limited because Mika's a professional model here in New York. So she needs to keep a very similar silhouette. So
hence the gorgeous bone structure.
Yes. Yeah.
You got an easy job tonight.
So what we're going to do is I'm going to have a traveling guide right now. And we're going to work this graduation right here, kind of above the occipital. And then everything below the occipital, we're going to elevate that quite high. Reason being is that I want to leave as much of this length as I have in the perimeter to keep that soft silhouette still. And then it will still feel like a similar vibe that she had before, but an entirely new shape throughout the entire interior of her haircut.
So is this something fairly common when you're dealing with kind of Asian bone structure, trying to kind of build up the occipital area a little bit more?
Most definitely.
Yeah.
I feel like anytime I'm cutting hair, it's either to build some kind of structure back into the shape because of the bone structure, or it's to take away from some type of bone structure. You know, but Mika's got great structure everywhere, so it's just like, let's enhance where we can, which there's really not much we can enhance on her because she's already great. But you can see her hair as we lift this hair up. This is really kind of getting elevated, and we're going to be taking off a lot less through this nape area.
So I think that's a great point. Lots of hair cutting is either constructive or deconstructive. You're either kind of building something up or maybe breaking something down. And that sometimes affects the choice of tools. You mentioned that you might use a scissor and the razor on this haircut.
Most definitely. So what I'm trying to do right now is I'm working with the scissor because I really want to create that structure. This is kind of like the foundation to my haircut. And this is how I typically work, is that the scissor is when I'm trying to really build something structured. And then I'm going to go back in with the razor and some other areas of the cut to really just kind of personalize it and create a sense of softness in the places that I don't need it to be structured.
All right, guys, so you can see that I'm monitoring the questions. Sal's a great educator, and he's got a lot to share here. So if you have any questions about haircutting, or if you want to know anything about Davinez or any of Sal's exciting projects, because I know he's got a lot going on in his career right now, we'd love to hear your questions. I want to give some shout-outs. Ayla's watching. Our great friend here from Davinez. She's watching. She says, hi, Frank Mussolino, of course. It wouldn't be an HB Live without Frank Mussolino. Mari Jones from Richmond. And are you going to be in Richmond for Hair on Stage?
I am. My whole team's going to be in Richmond
for it. Super exciting. So Davinez has a great event going on in Richmond, Virginia next month, I believe May 21st, 22nd.
Yes.
21st, 22nd in Richmond, Virginia, called Hair on Stage. Angelo Seminara is going to be there. Sal Misseri. Who else is going to be there, Sal?
Joseph DiMaggio.
Joe DiMaggio.
And I think Ion.
Yep.
And Ion Studio. Yeah. Incredible.
So I'm super excited for that. That's going to be a blast.
Great.
Great company.
So you started to progress a little bit the haircut. Tell us a little bit about what you're thinking with the hairline, because that can always be challenging with a strong Asian hairline.
Yeah, so Mika's hairline right now, we kind of talked about this earlier, is that her hair kind of grows up throughout the bottom. So we're actually going to detail some of that out. I asked her if it was okay if we kind of shave some of that out, and she said, yeah, she likes that.
Mm-hmm.
But we're going to still keep some of this excess length here really soft. I'm not going to go in and detail it out really hard. So I still want this softness. That's why I'm trying to elevate this right now and pull this hair up so that as it falls, it really diffuses this line and goes with the natural hairline. We can kind of see right now how much softer this is and sits into the skull compared to on this side. It just kind of falls flat, and you can see the heaviness here. So I'm going to keep working through this area, keep leaning this out, but hopefully you start to see, especially when it dries, we start getting a little bit more round here compared to this really flat edge right there.
Yep, so again, lots of love coming in from everyone. Ayla wants to make sure that we clearly mention that Angelo Seminaro will be in Richmond. Of course he will. Angelo's the Global Artistic Director for Davinez, and he's just one of the most inspiring hairdressers in the world. And he'll be there along with this incredibly talented gentleman. And Ion Studio, as well as Joseph DiMaggio. So it'll be a really well-rounded show in Richmond, Virginia. And if you're interested in that, I know that you can look for tickets on Bookio.com. Look under North America, Davinez North America, and you can find the different tickets for what's happening. All right, let's get back into this technique.
So still working this through here, and if you kind of watch, as I lift, I'm pulling the fingers up. So I'm trying to get back to the elevation that I had above the occipital. So very little length is coming off here. You know, it's, you have two things when you're cutting that I pay attention to most. It's either the length or the weight. So right now we're trying to build the weight up while maintaining the length down.
Excellent. So a good old friend of mine, Scott Clark, is watching. And Scott's a great, talented hair cutter out from Northern California. And he wants to know if your goal is to kind of make a rounded shape through the back here, since you started behind the ear and you're working into the middle.
Yes, it is. I'm definitely over-directing slightly back each time. So I do want to keep a little bit more of a round shape because I want to put a peak of weight right above the occipital where it should sit in. So again, because of the skull structure right now, I don't know how easy it is to see from the on the web viewing, but this to me is still very flat, but I'm starting to get a really nice bevel through the side right here. So that's kind of what I want to do, is I want to fill in this weight right here where the occipital should be, almost building a false occipital bone.
Building a better head shape.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's, I always remember that line from Christopher Brooker when he was cutting the firefly. I'm sure you've seen the original firefly video, which is kind of the beginning of Beautiful Round Graduation, the wedge, the firefly, and he uses the line, building a better head shape. And I think that, you know, Julie Klein asked the question, she's a frequent viewer, so she has a hard time visualizing when she starts behind the ear how the weight is going to be in the center. And I think you just, with that comb, you really showed it beautifully, that rounded shape.
Yeah, I have to have almost like tools to help me visualize, and a lot of times when I work, if anyone ever takes a class with me or something, you'll see me like come around with combs and I start almost mapping it out three-dimensionally for my eyes so I can see. I don't ever just kind of go in there and start cutting, because for the same thing you said, it's hard to understand where it's going to be at. So I kind of try to map it and think, okay, which shape do I want? And do I want it really round, or do I need it just, you know, just slightly mirroring the head? And I think it really works, you know, coming in before too, when we first got Mika in here, I spent a few minutes just sitting here feeling her head and like starting to see where the bone structure was, where it's turning away from me. We're going to kind of go over that more later when we get to the sides, but I know the most important thing to me when I'm cutting hair is the bone structure, you know, and it's making sure that you're paying attention to what it's doing, because it's either always doing two things. It's either moving with you or moving away from you. So you got to pay attention to that at all times and know what it's going to do to that shape underneath.
Excellent. Great, great advice. So again, lots of love coming in here. Yes, Allison, you might not say building a better head shape to the client, but sometimes you could. You know, sometimes people get that. I think if you have a pretty flat head shape, you know, it happens a lot with Asian clients in particular, mm-hmm. like Mika. They kind of know that their head shape's flat in the back, and they might say, you know, can you do something in the back there? And that's where this ground graduated technique comes in. Again, guys, please share your questions for Sal, anything related to the haircut. What's happening in his career, which we'll get into in a minute because he's got lots of exciting things going on. Tell us a little bit about your affiliation with Davinez. I know there was a big announcement recently that you're working kind of as like a global educator with Davinez. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, so the Davinez thing happened very organically. It was randomly one day I was in the salon, and I knew of the company mainly because I knew of Angelo. You know, Angelo is, to me, he's one of the best hairdressers alive. So I always paid attention to him, and I knew he was with a company. But I got a message from Anna Pacito, which none of you guys know who she is.
She's a hairdresser up in Montreal. She's been on an HB Live, I think, probably back in the 20s, number 20s.
Yeah, I mean, she is so amazing. And she messaged me one evening. I was sitting in the salon, and she said, "Can you talk?" And anyone knows that usually if you get a message from that, especially if someone who's a little bit older than you, you probably think that you're in trouble. So that's what I thought. I was like, oh, I must have put something
I pissed off Anna Pacino.
I was like, what did I do?
That's
like,
somebody you don't want to make upset.
Right.
And she's the sweetest person in the
exactly.
world.
Exactly. Yeah. So she's like, can we talk? And then I was like, yeah, most definitely. Like, put it in my head. I'm like thinking, what did I do? I start sweating. We got on the phone and she's like, what do you know about Davinas? And I was like, you know, not that much. Why? And she goes, I just joined them and I really want you to come on board. Like, would you be willing to have a meeting? And I was like, yeah, I'm always willing to meet with anybody. So she's like, okay, great. Let me see when they can have a meeting. Turns out that one of the other main guys from Davinas, Pier Paolo, he happened to be in Chicago. And he was like, let's just set up like a coffee meeting the next day. You know, it'd take 20 minutes. Well, that 20-minute meeting turned into almost 8 hours. Pier Paolo had to rearrange his flights. I had to rearrange all my clients. And then the rest was history from there.
Sounds like you got recruited.
Yeah.
Awesome. Awesome. All great people. Pier Paolo, if he's watching, say what's up. I've known Pier Paolo for over 25 years. Definitely a great person and someone who's helping to spread the love for Davinas to lots of great craft hairdressers. So let's get back into your technique now. You're basically working with kind of diagonal back sections. They're a bit more upright as yeah. opposed to really horizontal. Can you tell us why?
So I started doing that. Originally, I was going to work almost horizontal, but Mika was blonde not too long ago.
Really?
And
blondes have more fun? Yeah, yes.
And I noticed some areas in here that were a little bit short, and I'm going to guess were just from some color. So I wanted to kind of use that as my guide. So I'm not going as short as some of them were, but originally I wanted to work horizontally and build this up. But I knew for this that I could create the movement and this top's gonna be disconnected. So it would still work out. But typically I still almost always work with something semi-diagonal. I don't know why, I'm just not the biggest fan of completely vertical sections.
It's kind of more organic, isn't
yeah.
it? Because the head's not square, it's
exactly.
spherical. And you divide it up with kind of more curvilinear sections.
Yep. Yeah.
I agree. And it's kind of more fluid. You just kind of feel the shape.
Exactly. I feel like I can move just much easier around the head.
Awesome. We got a lot of our strong community members here. Danielle Green, thanks for joining. Sasha is watching from London.
Hey, Sasha.
That's incredible. Thank you so much. Julie is here. Lots of our longtime viewers and supporters, and thank you so much. I want to ask you guys, as I always do about this point, please hit that share button so all your friends can get to see this incredible education and learn from Sal and experience the beauty of Davinas. So we did have a question about what type of comb you're using. If you want to talk a little bit about your tool, Sal, people always appreciate that.
Oh yeah, this is the Sesabon. I got this one from Hairbrained Pro.
Shameless plug.
Yeah, but no, you know what? I typically either use this comb or I have the new YS Park 365, which it's got a little more weight to it, and I've really been liking that one a lot, too. So
tools are a big deal to you.
Oh, yeah. I mean, yeah. I'm a tool snob.
It kind of defines craft hairdressers, you
yeah.
know? And we say it all the time. You know, great tools don't make your work great, but if you do great work and you have great tools, it's even better.
Yeah.
You know? They don't, it's
sure.
not the tool that makes it great, but they're designed better and they're more effective. And this is, you know, one of the most classic combs. The Sesabon 20, it's a beautiful classic cutting comb.
Definitely. And then the scissors are BMAC. I've been using BMAC exclusively for the last about 4 or 5 years. And these are the PC models, which unfortunately you can't get these in the States.
Oh, you really are a snob.
Yeah.
He's got an exclusive pair.
And the reason being is that most of the shears or scissors, whatever you want to call them, that I used to use, I used to have to put a lot of finger grips through them because I don't like those big, loose finger grips. So these come
yeah.
from Japan, and they're already made small.
Right.
So
talk a little bit about how you hold your scissor, because I think that even that basic lesson, you know, obviously you don't want too big of a hole because you just barely put your thumb in there, don't you?
Yeah. So when I try to hold and I teach them, it's like you put it in your hand, and say it starts here, and I pull back with my pointer finger, and my thumb only comes and sits on the edge. So what's great about like scissors that are crafted so well is that they already have an indent cut in them, so it's super smooth. But whether I'm sitting in here and cutting graduation, my thumb can still stay in the same place. Or if I need to cut layers, I can sit right on top. And same thing is my thumb never goes through the hole, so I have no stress on my wrist. You know, so if I'm cutting through here, it's completely flat, but I can pivot quite quickly.
Thanks, guys, for hitting the share button. We've just shot up to over 358 live viewers. We really appreciate that. Thank you, Svetla Latova, for hitting the share button and everybody else that did. Let's get back into this graduation here now, Sal. So let's give us some tips about what's happening here.
So again, still working the graduation. I'm going to work slightly past center just so we can mirror these together. But right now we can start seeing that this has a little bit more fullness through here. You know, but I'll still maintain that length. I didn't take off any length here because as we over-directed this hair up, you know, the length of it fell out, which was the whole
goal.
Gives
you lots of options on the hairline.
Yeah.
And her hairline sits surprisingly flat for, yeah, you know, what you think. Yeah, so you're lucky. You're yes. You picked the right model.
Exactly.
When we first... Hi, Mika.
Hey. No, when we first started looking at
Get
it,
the
I was...
clippers!
I was like, oh, we're going to have to undercut this and let this hang over. But no, she's... You know, it's got a little bit of a whirl right there, but we'll kind of detail that in probably with a razor a little bit later, just leave that soft. But right now, I love how that's sitting. So kind of coming up through, we're just gonna check, make sure we've got everything. We got one little hair that escaped our scissor somehow.
So what?
That's good.
In terms of cross-checking, what are your thoughts there? Do you wait a little bit longer, or are you gonna get into that right now?
I'm actually doing that right now. You know, it's, I will cross-check opposite way that I came through, and I'm just looking for that soft curve coming through and nothing too far out of place.
Great question coming in from Allison Donham. She's asking about tension. So, what, you know, are you using a lot of tension, and what are your thoughts in terms of tension here?
So, you know, I learned tension, the lesson on tension, from another one of my favorite hairdressers, Steve Moody. And he told me there's a difference in tension. It's the difference between a rhino and an elephant. And if you take a rhino into a china shop, it just destroys everything. You take an elephant into that china shop, they're the same size, but it can take its trunk and move things gently and maneuver its way through. So I typically don't use a ton of tension. I try to be like the elephant, and as funny as
so
that
sounds.
So
the comb kind of controls it, and you just gently hold it in place.
Yeah. The teeth, you know, determine it more so for me. And I'm using the wide teeth, because I want it to sit loose and kind of sit exactly where it's at. I don't want it to spring back on me. You know, any type of hair, especially when you're dealing with hair this texture, it could jump back and almost stick up on you. So with having that little bit softer of tension, I know when it falls, it's going to sit exactly in that space. Where if I kind of turned it and really cranked on it, you know, it's going to give me a whole different effect because I'm going to pull some of it off the scalp a little bit, but it might shrink back more than I actually want it to. So I'm kind of working this, you know, I'm cutting it when it's wet, but I'm kind of letting it air dry slightly to see where it's going to fall into place. And having this type of hair texture that we're working on, you can do that relatively easily, and you can start seeing if that shape's the shape that you actually wanted. Otherwise, you can start refining it.
So we had a question coming in from Nina O'Brien Bailey. Does Davinez run classes out of the New York City location? This actual location is the headquarters. Ion Studio is here in New York, and that's kind of like an academy space where they do regular classes here. And then there's also special events done around New York City, and you can pretty much always find those by following Davinez through social media, through Hairbrained. We're always promoting what's happening there. So Sal, let's talk about the haircut and how it's developing.
Yeah, so now that we're done with the back, okay, we have this softer silhouette coming in here. We have a little bit more curvature to the occipital. Now we're gonna get into the sides. Now, I kind of parted this off earlier, and one of the things I kind of want to stress is paying attention to the bone structure. So if we put this comb flat on our head, it goes flat until the top of that section, and then the head turns away. So we're going to work graduation in multiple subsections. So I'm going to work it in this area, and then keep that same angle, and then work it off this top area. So we're going to work this a little more triangular up front, because I want to leave some length and softness towards the face. But hopefully...
So you take that guideline now from behind the ear, and you're going to start to work in the opposite direction. Going to use a little bit of overdirection to keep a little more length around the face.
Yep.
Is that for more options, or you know you want to keep, you're going to have a much longer piece in the front?
I just wanted a little bit more length in that front to create some different options, but some softness. Now the same thing is going to kind of happen is I'm going to elevate this a little bit higher, because I want to keep this soft that's going to fall through here. So we're still going to have that graduate angle to my, as I'm holding it, let me get it. Good grip.
Or you're not holding it down really low, so it's not going to be really kind of wedgy looking.
Nope,
it's a lean graduation.
Definitely. You know, just a little more contemporary of a feel to it.
So here's a question that comes up a lot, you know, and I always love to explore these things. So some people, when they cut hair, they always cut palm to palm.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I notice you're holding your scissor backhand.
Mm-hmm.
And do you have any reasoning why you feel like this works better for you versus palm to palm, or is it just what happens naturally?
Just what happens naturally. You know, yeah. It's comfortable for me. So I think it depends on which scissor I'm using too, depending on how those handles. If it's a crane handle or a straight handle, I tend to hold things based on that.
Yeah. You know, the advice I always give to people is that, you know, don't follow dogma. If someone says you should always do something a certain way, be dubious.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's lots of different ways to do things well. And you don't always have to cut palm to palm. You don't always have to cut over the palm. Try a lot of different things and see what works. And you know what? If you're going to have a long career, you're going to need to do things in a lot of different ways, both physically and mentally.
Oh,
so, 100%. You know, I just always try to get that point in there to avoid dogma. There is no right and wrong. I remember Trevor Sorby saying this when I was a young hairdresser in the late 80s. As long as it looks good, there is no right and wrong. It's all about the end result. And I definitely take that to heart.
There's
a great question coming in from Marcos Morales. What are your biggest inspiration when it comes to your editorial work? So we'll talk a little bit. Sal is someone who's been nominated, I think, over 9 times for NAHA. He's been putting out incredible collections and beautiful editorial work. So tell us a little bit about who some of your inspirations are.
Man, it's a tough one because I get inspiration from everywhere.
And it might not necessarily be hairdressers.
Yeah, it's not always hairdressers. You know, I see a lot of inspiration just from artists in general. You know, you could look at, you know, painting, sculpture, buildings. I'm from Chicago, so there's a lot of great architecture, so I get a lot of inspiration from there. But I, you know, for hairdressers-wise, I would say, again, Angelo. And it's
yeah, you mentioned Angelo and Stephen Moody.
Yeah. You know, Tracy from Sassoon.
Tracy Sakasich from Sassoon.
Yeah, like, those are some of my favorites that I constantly look to.
So you're definitely kind of inspired a bit by the Sassoon approach to cutting hair?
Yeah, you know, the beginning of my career was hardcore Sassoon. I wanted to cut everything as sharp and as clean as possible, but as I've kind of grown, I started, I think, mixing and matching and kind of trying to combine multiple, I don't know, different techniques of hairdressing to create my own.
I think that's such great advice for people watching. You know, and we hear, you know, we've now broadcast and worked with so many different hairdressers, and it's kind of a general theme. Very rarely does anyone say, just pick up scissors and do whatever you feel from day one. Go for it.
Yeah.
You know, generally that's not good advice. You know, people will say, get some great training, learn the foundations, find something Sassoon or something like Sassoon. There's also French foundations, and there's different foundations, but they're all focused on being able to control hair and put shape into hair. And then once you have that, make it your own. That's when you start to kind of change it up and make it your own. All right, so back to the haircut. You're moving up the head shape now a little bit. So tell us what's happening.
So right now I looked where the head started to adjust again. And this is where it started turning away from me. So I'm going to match this up to the guide below it. Still working the same over direction. But I want to keep the same angle that I had before, but the angle is consistent off of the head shape. You know, and I've always found that cutting this, like, you know, if you want to consider this like a bob, or, you know, in between a pixie and a bob, is that people always forget that the head's doing something different than what they're doing. So it tends that they'll start cutting, they follow straight out when the head started rounding away from me. So I try to make sure I'm always mimicking, not just horizontal, but vertically as well. And then this top we're going to leave disconnected. So we want this interior of it to be a bit shorter than it was previously. But overall, the length is still going to feel very similar. Like I said earlier, we had to keep a very similar silhouette for Mika, just because, you know, she needs it for her job. But we still wanted something different and fresh for her.
So basically now you're carrying that line up through the sides. The head's curving away from you, so it's actually continuing to build a little bit of weight.
Yep.
Yeah, so it'll have still kind of a bit of a lean, graduated feeling to it.
Definitely. Yep.
And then you'll do the same thing through the opposite side, or will there be some asymmetry?
No, I think we're going to do the same thing on the opposite side, but it's going to look a little asymmetry because of the actual skull shape. You know, again, like, I started measuring it and seeing where the head started rounding away. So if you were to look at this in the beginning, this side is slightly higher, but that's because the skull structure is there. So I want it to visually be the same, not technically be the same. And that's another thing I focus on a lot, is making sure that visually, I think it's more important for me the haircut looks great, then technically if someone goes through and cross-checks my work and says, oh, well, that piece is different. Well,
that was a big lesson for me as a young hairdresser training where, you know, I remember it specifically, one of my teachers, a guy named Tennessee, who maybe he's watching, what's up, Tennessee? He said sometimes you have to cut asymmetrical for it to actually be symmetrical because of the head shape or growth patterns. You know, you can't just cookie cutter everything. It can actually look worse that way.
Yeah.
Hey, Marina. Marina Lantos is watching, another brilliant hair cutter who was featured a few weeks ago. She's excited that we've had two short haircuts in a row. We had a short haircut last night, and we've got another one tonight, so that's fantastic. People love to see that beautiful technique. Again, guys, we're here with Sal Misseri. We're here in New York City at the Davinez headquarters, kind of becoming our home away from home. Sal's in town from Chicago to share this technique with you here. So again, if you're enjoying it, please ask questions, show your love, and hit that share button so all your hairdresser, hairbrained friends can watch as well. It's our pleasure to bring you this education, completely complimentary. We're now into our 61st video with these great lessons, and we hope you guys are enjoying it, and we want you to share. So Sal, moving into the second side, tell us a little bit about what's happening.
So now I'm just doing the exact same thing I did on the other side. We're working the graduation. We're keeping the elevation quite high. You know, the sections are close to being vertical, and the over direction is slightly back to create that triangular shape. But again, we want to keep this lean. We want to keep it something a little more contemporary. Don't want it like to look like anything that's been done too much before. But I want some, like, I don't know, a little bit of surprise for it. So that's why we're going to work with that disconnection, is that, you know, it's like I said, it's going to be a similar silhouette to what we had. But once this hair moves and we kind of actually get to blow dry it and put a little texture in there, it's going to really bring it to life.
So Sal, as you continue to work through this side, tell us a little bit about what's happening. I know you've got exciting things happening in your career and in your salon life. Tell us about what's happening for you.
Oh, a lot. So a year ago, almost to the month, I started an education company, which is called Kaizen, which is a Japanese word for constant self-improvement or change for the good. And I did that because I didn't get to where I am because of just myself. You know, I have an entire team that works with me. So I wanted to make sure that we all had kind of the opportunity to be like seen. So I created that, and I was working for another salon company in Chicago. And then I joined Davinez. Well, last week, me and that entire team that I built for the last 7 years of being in Chicago just opened up our new salon. So it's a salon in Chicago. It's called Reverie. So you guys want to go see what we're doing?
So Reverie, what part of town is it in Chicago? People wanted to come in, because people always like to visit salons when they're in big cities.
Yeah, so it's in River North. So it's right downtown. It's where all the restaurants, bars, everything else is down there. So it's a great spot. And we're going to actually host education out of there. So we're going to have an academy in that space as well. It's kind of built out perfectly for hairdressers. So it's somewhere really cool. We'll definitely start putting up class dates probably in the next few weeks on our Instagram. Our Instagram's Kaizen Education. You know, we try to make sure that we just share as much knowledge as we possibly can with everyone. You know, we want to elevate this crap as much as possible.
Well, you're definitely doing that now. You've just shot up to 420 live viewers at this particular second, so that's great. Everybody's out there enjoying it. So recap what's happening, Sal. Lots of people have just joined. You've graduated the back, and now you're moving into the sides. Technically, explain to us what's happening.
So right now, I'm still working this graduation. I'm working that off of the head shape. So, you know, graduation is from, basically, it's working shorter to longer, so the elevation is typically kept low. If any of you guys are familiar with Sassoon, this would be more of like an internal graduation. We're not building up something of a wedge.
We're it's trying leaner to, and higher.
Yeah, leaner and higher. Trying to build this weight up.
It's more modern, isn't
yes.
it? In most cases.
Yep.
Usually a low kind of heavy graduation. People tend to think it has kind of like a 70s look to it. Which can be a great thing. I don't mean that in a negative way, but these leaner internal graduations that maybe turn into disconnection or longer layers, most people feel are a bit more contemporary.
Definitely. So getting to that point now where I'm going to start letting some of this hair drop, because like I said earlier, we're going to work with some disconnection. So I kind of want to see now what the hair is doing.
Okay, so just to recap before we move on, it was like kind of a rounded graduation through the bottom, building this beautiful head shape, then taking the guide over directing slightly to get a kind of a triangular, a little bit of stuff around the face. Now Sal's got all this loose disconnection on the top, and this is where we're going to get some exciting things, I think, happening, aren't we, Sal?
Yeah, and this is probably about the point, too, where I'm going to switch to one of the razors.
Oh, yeah, this is what I've been waiting for. You know, I love razor cutting, so I'm excited. And I always love to watch other people use the razor because it's such a personal tool, and yeah, people approach it so differently, so I'm really excited to see you use this. Do you combine scissor and razor a lot?
I do a lot.
Awesome.
You know, it's like I said earlier, it's scissors are for me really building a structure, and razor is for me being me. You know, I feel like that's, I get to be more of an artist in a way with a razor. Not saying that a scissor's not artistic, yeah, it's just a different type.
It's just a different, it tunes into your frequencies a little bit different, mm-hmm, you know? It's so organic working with the razor. Again, once you have that incredible technique, you can work with anything, you know?
Yeah,
if you understand hair and shape and technique, you can cut hair with a piece of broken glass. Excellent. So, fill us in on what's going to happen now.
So now we're going to look and see where this hair is kind of falling and sitting at right now, that's in the back and the crown area. So what I'm going to do is I want to make it look like it almost blends in with this front line. So even though we're going to detail some of this, a lot of my disconnections, I still like to have a sense of connection to it. So, like I said, it's kind of like a surprise where people look at it and say, oh, is that disconnected or is it not? Let's get a little clip. Go ahead and hold this.
Take the second to say thank you, Aubrey McKay Flynn, for sharing, and thanks to everyone else. 21 people just shared. That's so important because we're trying to elevate the craft and we need to get as many people to see these great lessons as possible.
Okay, so if we take a look here, this is the length that's disconnected on the top. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to treat this almost as like if I did a normal graduated bob, and I built that graduation up and then continued forward. So we're going to pretend this is our bob line. And we're going to take this hair out. And we're just going to lightly start cutting this triangular a little bit. So we'll start seeing this shape in. And it's going to blend right into the side, even though everything underneath here is short. So I think that's what's kind of cool, is that you get this fun sense of movement without it ever looking like it was just a chunk of hair sitting somewhere.
I love how you're kind of combining these different beautiful fundamental shapes to make something of your own. You had the round graduation in the back, the triangular graduation on the sides, and now you're overlapping it. I love how you mentioned kind of like a graduated bob. Mm-hmm. I think that's a great example of taking all these traditional classic shapes and making them your own. We used to say it's kind of like putting them in a blender to kind of come out with something original. Then you throw in a different bone structure and a different hair texture, and you've got something amazing. All right, so moving into the sides.
Yeah, so moving into the sides, I had to pull some more hair down until I get the hair that it's going to actually reach. And same thing, is I'm going to tilt her head away from me a little bit just so I can get this angle in. But again, I want a little bit shorter to longer, but right now the head's starting to round away. So when I do that, I have to angle my fingers back towards the chin. You know, it's still going to have a triangular cutting line, but it's going to keep it from getting too like dog ear-ish.
So I have a question about razors coming in from Jamie Jenko. Jamie, the black-handled razor and the wood-handled razor that we have on Hairbrained Pro, they're exactly the same. They're both feather pliés. The wood-handled one is a limited edition special razor where the handle's just made out of wood. It is a little heavier and a little bit thicker between the fingers. The black one is the traditional one. It's a very high-quality polycarbon plastic that's almost impossible to break. The wood one is a special limited edition. We probably have about 75 or 80 left. So if you're a razor cutter and you love your tools, you might want to get the wood one, but the plastic one is high quality. That's the only difference, is just the wood versus the plastic.
I just ordered that wood one yesterday.
I saw that. You're tool snob.
As soon as I saw that pop up, I had to have one.
Thank you, Kendra Hearn, for sharing. We appreciate that. So again, let's get into razoring. Are you doing lots of razoring in the salon?
We actually have been doing a real lot more than recently. You know, and for a while we had it where clients were scared of razors. And I think it was just our job as hairdressers to start educating them and telling them, you know, it's not the razors that cause the damage, it's the person who is using it most likely. You know, and they were razor shy for sure. But, you know, our salon, lucky enough that we have a lot of people. I'm going to turn this more towards,
I mean, you know, strangely it happens with all trends. You know, mm-hmm, if you think back to the 70s and the 80s, perms were huge.
Yeah.
And then people pushed it so far that it became scary. Razor cutting was huge for decades, and people pushed it so far that it became scary. You know, things with color, we might be going in that direction too. You know, but that's just the nature of what we do. We take something, we get success with it, we push it as far as we can, and then it becomes Uggs, is the best way I can put it. It's like, they were really cool and they were great, but they kind of lost their cool appeal. And that's kind of what happens. And as hairdressers, we have to be ahead of that curve all the time.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen that saying going around Facebook, like the little memes, that's like, trendy is the step before tacky.
That's exactly right.
Yeah, it's
exactly right. And it's our job to always be ahead of that curve.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, it's just trying to create trends, you know, and trying to be ahead of them at the same time, because it's stuck. I mean, we were talking earlier about when, like, creating collections and things like that, and that was one of the things saying is that I always try any work that I do to make sure it never looks like anything else I've ever done in the past. You know, I don't ever want anyone to look at my work and know it's my work. You know, there should always be a sense of, like, a signature to it, but never something identical every time. At least that's how I feel.
Are you doing any photography yourself, or are you always do you work with a certain photographer, or
changing
it up all the time?
I work with a main photographer. His name's John Rawson. He's from London. He shoots all of my stuff.
But that's someone you've been nominated with many times?
Yeah, last few years we've had quite a bit.
Did you shoot with him again this year?
Yeah.
Yeah? And you excited for the announcements? I believe May 10th we hear who the nominees are for the Nahas this year.
Yeah,
I have a feeling you'll be in there again. It's becoming a tradition.
I'm hoping so. And yeah, I mean, me and John shot together, but then I also shoot a lot of stuff too, so I shot a lot for our team. And then we have another photographer that we've been working with that the education team that we have a production team of it as well. That's photographers, videographers, because we want to be able to produce everything that we're possible. And the other one's Kevin Alexander. He's really great. He's out of Denver. So if anybody out in Denver wants someone to shoot with, you know.
What was his name again?
Kevin Alexander.
Kevin Alexander in Denver.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people in the middle of the country are looking like, who's a great photographer? Maybe they can't afford to go to LA or New York. So shout out to him. Here's a great question that I want you to. First, tell us what you're doing and we'll get to the question.
So right now what I'm going to do is I'm going to start working into this fringe area. So again, earlier Mika and I had a talk and we were kind of discussing the fringe, and she said she still wants it below the brows, but she still wants it soft because she might kind of push it over to the side. She might wear it down, she might wear it both ways. You know, she wants something open. So I already knew that I was going to go more towards the razor. Now, previously in her haircut, she already had some short layers up here, so there's kind of a disconnection as it is going through this fringe, so it kind of got a little bit heavier and longer. So I'm going to take away some of that weight through these ends, but not take away as much weight through here because it's already done for me. You know, and me and Gerard were talking earlier too. It's not always about what you cut off. It's what you leave on.
It's definitely what you leave on. Nobody looks at what's on the floor and says it looked great.
Yeah.
They look at what's on their head. Absolutely. So here's a couple great questions as you start to razor there. So first one, this comes up a lot from Brandy Sailor. Do we think that the razor is only acceptable on certain hair types, or do you use it on lots of different hair types? How do you feel about that, Sal?
I personally use it on a lot of different hair types. You know, I would say...
I'm with you.
I mean, I think it's prep too can help. You know, it's I don't
prep in terms of the product you put in, the conditioner that you use. Absolutely.
You know, because some people get scared of not putting it on doing a razor on curly hair and things. I use it all the time. You know, I just might put more leave-in conditioners in it so it's got a little bit more slip and glide.
Yeah. As someone who has very curly hair, I always prefer my hair cut with the razor, or cut well with the razor, because it puts more air and space into the curls and allows the curl to kind of fall in a more fluid way. But again, just like anything, it's your training and how you work with it.
For sure.
Then the other question that I really love, this one from, I believe that was from Dalby Markham. Do you feel the razor helps create a seamless effect, or do you use it to create texture? And that's a really, you got to think about that one for a minute.
I think it's both.
I think it's both too.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. And it's how you rotate the blade and how you use it. So you can actually cut really clean and invisible with the razor, which is wonderful for graduation.
Yeah.
Like what you did here with this, it melted in. But you can also use it to break things up and make it really, really loose and soft.
For sure.
So I think that's a really thoughtful thing. I love it.
So what I'm going to do right here now is I already have my length kind of cut in. And I still may detail that when it's dry. But you can see that we have, let's kind of ribbon this hair together a bit. You can see the softness to that bottom edge. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come in here with this razor. I'm going to treat it almost like an eraser. We're going to use the tip of the blade. I'm going to see where it's kind of heavy, and we're just going to lightly just start tipping in there, just to almost erase a little bit of weight. So not a ton, but enough to create a little bit of space and a little bit of interest.
Great to see this up close work. Yeah. You know, we were working last night with our friend Lee Clapson, who's a great razor cutter, and he said this brilliant thing about catching a butterfly in your hand. It was very touching about how gently he tries to work with the razor. He's like letting the butterfly land in your hand. And as I was watching you there, it made me think about that. These analogies are so important. Okay, we've got a question coming in from Jonathan Kranz. Would you say how open or closed the razor should be to determine your shape? So are you using smaller or larger strokes? What's your thought process here?
Right now I'm using smaller strokes. Because I want to really keep this shape a little bit more clean throughout the bottom. It's still soft because that razor is giving me that nice diffused edge, but I'm not really coming in and really opening that blade up, because her density of hair is also, it's not overly thick through this area. So I don't want to take too much weight out where it starts looking sparse.
And tell us about your sections. They're, again, very curved, very curvilinear.
You know, I put the comb on her head, and I just let wherever the head starts rounding, the comb follows. And I do that a lot with the fringe area, because I want that hair right here to fall as naturally as possible. So, as we kind of move in here, my fingers roll a little bit as I go because the head rolls. So my elevation is, it starts lower, and then as I come across, I start rolling with it. So I try to be very, I don't know what the word is, like intuitive with the head shape.
I think intuitive is a great word with razor cutting, and organic, and kind of, it's when you're razor cutting, you can move the holding hand a lot more.
Yeah.
Like when you're doing precision haircut, scissor cutting, if you start rolling your hand, you get like something completely different and unplanned for. But with the razor, I find that rotation really helps to bring it to life.
Most definitely. You know, I love the freedom that you get with the razor. You know, and I love that precision that you can get with a scissor. But, I mean, you can also get a lot of freedom with a scissor as well. But
of course.
It's just...
As someone that worked at Sassoon for 10 years, where we were really forbidden to use razors, we had to learn every way possible to use a scissor like a razor. Yeah. And it can be done. You know, if you don't want to cut with razors, you don't need to use a razor. You can cut very softly with a scissor. I just enjoy cutting with everything, and I can tell Sal does as well. So I had a thought when we first kind of, I hadn't seen Sal in a while, and I remember many of you guys might know what the HB shootout is. It's when we do competitions and people put up photos and we give them a great award, like going to see a Davinez show or taking a class with Sassoon. Our very first HB shootout that we did, I think it was 2012, Sal was the first winner of an HB shootout. We were just talking about that earlier. And I, you know, in a big way, I'm really proud of all the success he's had since then. It's kind of incredible.
No, it was, you know, that was cool. That was one of my first times of really putting myself out there. I was, you know, a big follower of Hairbrained, and I loved seeing all the people's work on there. And it was always really inspiring. And I saw this HB shootout pop up, and it was like, you know, get a chance to go work with
Mark Hayes and Tracy Sackassitz, Steve Moody at the time. Yeah,
everyone. And I was like, okay, I have to do this. So, you know,
I remember the photo was like by the window, and I think you had like curls on the top, and it was like kind of undercut. Yeah, I remember.
So, I did that shootout. I got lucky enough to win, and that really changed my career, because I went to Santa Monica. I got to hang out with Tracy and Mark and Steve and all these people backstage while they're prepping, and just, you know, I will never forget watching, my scissors, not actually going to cut, but I remember watching Mark work, and everything was so diligent. It was like,
he's the architect.
Yeah, and it was just like so perfect and moving in there. And I remember sitting behind him just like trying to mimic his fingers.
Yeah.
And like keep doing that.
And some of us have been doing that for 30 years.
Yeah.
And these fingers are never going to mimic those fingers. I gave up a while ago.
And so, you know, right after that, about 2 months later, I shot my first Nighthawk collection, and that was the first one that I was nominated 3 times with that collection.
That's amazing. Amazing.
I won with one of them.
I love that story.
Yeah, I don't think I really would have... Probably the inspiration came from working with those guys, and I don't know if necessarily I would have, shot the same way if I didn't go there.
So lots of people asking what you put in there. This was the Your Hair Assistant Blow Dry Primer. This is designed by Angelo Seminara with Davinez.
Yes.
What? Tell us a little bit about this product and why you chose it.
It sure does smell good in here.
Sure does smell good.
Nice.
Smell-o-vision.
Smell-o-vision.
It's that blow dry primer is my most favorite hair product ever made.
I used it 2 weeks ago. I had to give it to my model.
Yeah, it's beautiful because it's light and it gives you the hold. It can give you body or you can smooth hair out. Yeah, my girlfriend has extremely coarse curly hair, super long, and we've blown her hair out completely smooth with just that product alone. And we were all kind of just blown away. Like, how is this even possible? So in the salon, that's our go-to. It's that, and you'll see the texturizing spray, the dry texturizing that we use a lot too. But I always joke with clients that you put me on a deserted island, if you give me those two products and something sharp, I can do whatever.
Awesome. You know? Okay, so now, of course, the big question is that the Dyson blow dryer? Tell us, do you like it? Everybody wants to know.
Yeah, I do.
It's definitely pretty quiet.
It is. You know, it's we have them right now in the salon because we wanted something really quiet. And since I knew that I was going to be on video here, we wanted something so you guys could still hear me.
Yeah, I need to get one for everybody that does an HD Live. I met with the people when they were the Dyson company when they're here at IBS. I just need to follow up because I think they'd be so great for these HD Lives.
Yeah.
It is super quiet and
super
powerful.
Super light, yeah.
I wanted to circle back real quick to a question from Elizabeth. Would you shy away from using razor on very baby fine hair?
Not necessarily. I might just not do the whole haircut with it.
You know? Maybe not be so open with it. Yeah.
Yeah, just a little.
Remember the butterfly. Let the butterfly land on the hair.
So also too, like blow drying, we're just using a vest brush, 9-row, and just lightly just wrapping the head thick. You know, I'm not trying to force the hair to go anywhere it doesn't want to go.
It's a deceptively simple blow dry technique, isn't it?
Yeah.
You just, you know, using the head like a roller and directing the hair back and forth. Just sort of, it's kind of a hair cutter's blow drying technique.
Definitely.
It's going to bring out your haircut and allow you to refine it. Do you plan on doing some more cutting after it's dry?
Yeah, I think so. I think we're going to still refine some areas, you know, especially the outline areas, because we really want to personalize that. You know, we haven't done anything to the outline yet. That's all been just from elevation over direction that's created the softness. So I still have to kind of go in this and make it my own. You know, like right now I still feel like it's a little bit too much Mika. So gotta bring it to life a little bit.
Elizabeth Sherman, if you're interested in Davinez products, they've got salons all over the country. You can head over to the Davinez website, find the salon closest to you, and head in there, not only for great products, but for great hairdressers. Davinez is obviously producing product, but they also have education with people like Sal, training the salons that use Davinez products. So head over to davinez.com to the website and you can learn more about the product and learn about the salons that carry Davinez and are part of this kind of global family. Like Sal's salon in Chicago.
Yeah.
And so your salon will be exclusively Davinez?
Yeah, we're exclusively Davinez. And, you know, there was for a while there that I never thought I would do a single product brand again. Like I wanted to kind of keep multiples. And I can honestly say, and this is no BS, Davinez is the first brand that I've worked with that I was able to replace my entire session kit with just their product. That's the reason I'm with them. You know, I never really signed down with any other brand before. It's like I did everything freelance because I just felt like I couldn't commit to it because I was still using other people's products. You know, I might be having, you know, product this for straight hair, this brand for curly hair. And Davinez is really kind of won me over with that. And again, like I don't say that lightly. And I mean, that's the reason that I'm here with them.
Mika, everyone's saying how beautiful you look. Beautiful model, beautiful haircut.
Thank you very much.
Absolutely. Lots of love coming in, which is great. So at this stage, obviously, you're starting to think, well, you changed your technique. Explain what you're doing now with the brush.
Now we're just kind of leafing a little bit.
Leafing, yep. And we call it leafing because it's like turning the pages of a book. You're doing this motion. And why did you choose to do that?
So this top, I'm just kind of bring this forward a little bit and just smoothing this out. You know, I would normally be done with this blow dry about 5 minutes ago, but I'm trying to keep the blow dryer low so you guys can still hear. But I just want the hair, her hair is already very straight, but I want that little bit of a bevel through the fringe area.
My buddy Tim Bricker is watching. Tim, yes, it is the Dyson blow dryer. And it's light and it's a professional version.
This is the professional.
Do you know what the differences are?
I think it's just the cord.
Just the cord. Okay.
I believe that's what I was told. And the nozzle.
Oh, right.
This nozzle isn't heat resistant, so it gets hot. The consumer version has an outer layer so they don't burn themselves.
Oh, okay. Okay.
But besides that, it's very interesting. In different colors.
Awesome. Awesome. So wrap drawing, doing a little bit of leafing, starting to think about your finishing techniques in terms of cutting. Will you go back to the scissor, or do you like to use the razor on dry hair? That's always another big question.
I think we might switch to the feather razor.
The feather razor, the guarded razor.
Yeah, so we'll go to,
explain your thinking things there, because I like that. I'm kind of thinking the same way, but explain why you would switch to a guarded razor.
I like it because the teeth that kind of are on the guards kind of force you to skip a little bit of space. Mm-hmm. So I feel like you get a little bit more of that softness to it. It lets me really carve the hair. I can pinch and carve and move it around.
Yep, so I kind of work, I'm just going to turn you around so we get a better view here for the camera. Moving target. Excellent. Our buddy Joseph DiMaggio just joined. What part of the world are you in right now, Joseph? Are you here in New York or someplace else? Let us know. Again, we had featured Joseph few weeks ago here during Fashion Week. If you guys want to look back at our video collection on our Facebook page, all of these techniques, all of these demonstrations are all saved. You just go to the Hairbrained page on Facebook and you look in the video section. Right now we've got 61 of these live lessons and we've got hundreds of other videos and it's all completely free. Again, our whole goal is to elevate the industry. We work with brands that want to elevate the industry, but for our hairdresser friends, it's all free. So you can watch anytime, you can benefit from these great lessons, and you can keep asking questions even after the video is finished, and we try to go back and help answer those questions. So it's a constant source of education and inspiration. So you switch to the feather guarded razor. It's actually called the styling razor, which is the weirdest name. Like technically, it's called the feather styling razor, or the other one's the feather plie, in case you ever wanted to know the difference. And this one has a guard on it, and I prefer it for dry hair too because it's more gentle.
Yeah.
It pulls less.
So where we're going to really start detailing is right through here. Again, you can see that this is a sideburn area. And I think this is something else that a lot of times people forget about is that this hair dips down in front of the ear. So sometimes they're like, well, I cut that so perfect. Why is there longer hair there? It's just, it's the hairline. You got to forget that you still got to work with it. So we're going to really pick this hair up a bit.
Our buddy Travis Smith in Chicago is watching.
What's going on, Travis?
Yeah. Travis says it looks awesome, Sal. He's sending you some love.
As you can see, just lightly just starting to dust that off.
Thanks for noticing Cade Daffin, who's a longtime Hairbrained supporter. He mentions that it's great to see Davina's building such an amazing artistic team. And again, that's one of the reasons why Hairbrained has got involved with Davina's. They're one of our official sponsors, and I think it's a company that really gets it and is going in the right direction, doing great things for hairdressers. So we're proud to be sponsored by Davina's.
Yeah, I think it's cool because, Joseph DiMaggio, you said he was on there earlier. He was just in Chicago a couple weeks ago. Me and him got to go have dinner and talk. And, it is cool because I feel like with a lot of like-minded people are starting to join up with them. And, none of us felt forced to join them. It all happened very organically where we were just like, we loved what was going on. We loved the products. We loved the mission. And it was something we could believe in, and it's like, it's been a long time for me since I've seen anything I could believe in. So I'm excited about it. And I know everyone
else. And it's Italian.
Yeah.
So it's a no-brainer for guys like us.
Yeah, you can't go wrong.
Not for us, a couple of Italians, we have no problem with that. Excellent. Okay, so back into the details. I love what you did with the sideburns there. The cut.
Just soften them, but nothing too perfect. Pinch if you need to a little bit, but I still want that soft edge to it. But as we can see now from earlier, we have all the short stuff in here, but we still have this long hair that was connected all through the back, so it's going to give us a lot of movement. So this can kind of sit, but we can shake this loose. Just imagine how much cooler this would even look if we had some different color going on in here and some pops.
Yeah, actually, somebody mentioned that they love her color. So it was previously kind of bleached and there was a color put over it. Mm-hmm. But it's working out really, really beautifully. Again, lots of love coming in. Joseph does say he was teaching a class and he just finished the class and started watching. And he agrees Italians do it better. figures that Joseph DiMaggio would think that. All right, so this is crucial what's happening right now. You're doing some undercutting. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so she had a little bit of a hairline where it started to swirl up a little bit. And we talked earlier, and she said she, you know, kind of wanted that shaved a bit. So what I'm doing is I'm coming in, I'm going with the direction the hair grows.
She's kind of neutralizing it, huh?
Yeah, just, yeah. You know, soften that up. So
but you let that hair fall over it, so yeah. it's not a fade.
Right.
Yeah. So it's literally a miniature undercut, isn't it?
Yep, exactly. So same thing here. This hair is kind of growing up, so I tend to just kind of like going with it rather than against it. I've noticed sometimes if you go against the hair, and maybe it's just me noticing it, but sometimes you see like almost like get like a razor rash or like ingrown hairs more.
That's absolutely true.
So I'm just trying to follow with it and just lightly go right there. You can't really feel that, right, Mika?
Yeah, good. Yeah.
And then what we'll do now is that we have this hair back here is still a little bit thicker, but I kind of like this like airiness to some of these sides. So I'm gonna come in here and just pinch and lightly cut from both sides and just start detailing it.
Thanks for staying with us, guys. We still have hundreds and hundreds of live viewers, which is incredible. And just so you know, even afterwards, you can go back and watch these videos at any time. You can fast forward and rewind. You continue to ask questions and engage. We always keep our eyes out for that. So even if you didn't catch this from the beginning, you can watch as soon as it's done. You can go back to the beginning and watch and totally be engaged with what's happening. So just pinching now, I notice you're working in a lot kind of freer way.
Mm-hmm.
Not trapping it between the fingers, just pinching that hair together.
Yeah, I'm just like trying to feel for density in my fingertips. So like I said, I want to keep this softness. I want it to feel almost raw to it. So it's just...
So Sal, someone named Emily Chen says she loved taking your photography class at the Chicago show last month. Tell us about that. I didn't even hear about that one.
So, I mean, because I do photography as well as do hair, and the whole reason I did that was that there was a lot of hairdressers always asking me, like, how do I get into doing shoots for, like, NAHA and other awards and things like that, you know, and it was me trying to tell them to go to certain photographers and look at certain things, you know, and they might not have the budget, and then you have to remember that if you haven't worked on a shoot, you probably need guidance on not just the hair, but on the photography aspect. So... what I did is I picked up a camera, I started training myself, and I started buying a lot of different gear, better and better and better, and created the ability for me to help hairdressers shoot their own work, because I could help them with the hair, and then also shoot it. So we did a class at ABS a couple weeks ago, and it was great. We had a lot of people who were interested in shooting their own work, and then also... there's a great organization in Chicago. It's called Professional Salon Concepts. It's owned by Steve and Terry Cowan, who...
Great people. I'll be there in August. I'm doing a one-man gig at the new PSC space.
And so you have to come by the city and see us.
Yeah, definitely.
So they have been, like, nothing short of miracle workers.
Phenomenal. People that are dedicated to elevating the craft.
Yes, and... I totally forgot where we were going with that.
We're talking about photography.
Me and Anna Pacito got together 2 weeks ago, I think. Yeah, well, about 2 weeks ago. And we did a class where we partnered up and we taught a photography class where I think we had 75 people watch in the morning. And we did kind of a shoot, put it together. And they got to see us actually shoot the work as it was going and see how we, you know, address issues.
You know, coincidentally, Craig just joined.
Oh, really?
Cohen. Yeah. We're just talking about your parents and your family's business and how wonderful it is.
Yeah.
It's amazing. And then you must have got an alert.
So yeah, must have.
What's up?
And then in the afternoon, the 20 of those students got to work with me and Anna hands-on and got to create their own collections. So if you guys follow us on Instagram or Facebook, you'll see them up. They'll probably be out in the next, like, I'd say 2 weeks. But they get fully finished, retouched, competition... advertising ready pictures, which I think is really cool because, you know, it was shot by hairdressers, created by hairdressers. Like, I mean, the whole thing was hairdressers doing it.
I love that. And when is it going to be offered again? Do you have it on the books anywhere?
No, not yet. But me,
we
I know
set
me and,
that up.
Me and Anna are definitely talking about it. I seriously love that shade coming together.
Yeah, it's looking lots of love coming in. Just people saying how wonderful she looks.
Yeah.
Excellent. Just making those kind of final choices now. I love how you're just pinching that hair and just tapering it.
Yeah, just looking for some areas that I feel like might be a little heavy and just pinching, kind of trying to feel the density and just coming in and just detailing lightly. You know, there's really no rules to that. It's just what feels good and what looks good.
Especially if you put in a great shape like you did. You know, you're not fixing or correcting anything now. You're just seasoning. You know, it's just kind of that everything's there, the consistency, the texture. It's just right now, it's seasoned to taste. And, you know, since we're Italian, we add garlic, right?
Yeah.
Absolutely. So you're getting a little garlic in there right now.
No, that looks great. Again, that product, you know, the blow dry primer.
Which was this one here. This is the Your Hair Assistant.
Sprayed quite a bit of it on there.
Yeah.
You can saturate the hair with it, totally.
Yeah, you can't use too much of it, I feel like.
As a matter of fact, can I get a case of this before I leave tonight?
Yeah.
I gave mine away to the last model that I worked with.
You know, and it's... Can I get Your Hair Assistant powder brush?
That was one of the...
Is that one... Can I use that one?
Yeah.
So nobody can steal that one. Is that another one from Angelo?
So Angelo designed this. So Davina's obviously is a manufacturer that make all kinds of wonderful lines, and they partnered with their global artistic director, Angelo Seminara, and said, if you wanted to make your own line of products, what would it be? So this is Angelo's line for Davina's, and it's just such a beautiful, simple line. Maybe Kelly, you can get a shot of it after he does that. I love the packaging. It's just so simple and beautiful. And there's only a few, how many products? Less than 10, I think, altogether. Oh, yeah. And it's just really designed with hairdressers in mind.
Four styling products from it. And then
seven products altogether, which is great.
But this bamboo powder, I was showing Mika earlier because we were playing with it, but it's so light, and what's nice is that it doesn't get any, like, greasiness to it. You know, it absorbs everything, so it's kind of matte, but it just starts...
So this is the bamboo powder,
yeah.
And this is from the Your Hair Assistant line, and you're just kind of dusting it into
just
the roots.
Just dusting it through. I'm just trying to dirty your hair up a little bit more. You know, I don't want it to look like that fresh, washed look. I want that softness. And
so there's literally like a powder inside of this. Can you demonstrate how it works?
Yeah, so let's show you the powder up close. So it's literally like this little powder, and you dip that in there.
Dust it on there.
Well, it's already in the brush.
Yeah.
So it kind of gets suspends from inside, which is ingenious.
Mm-hmm. And then, so inside here.
Yep. And then you just, again, just... move it through. I think I've used most of it earlier playing with it, but
excellent.
But then when you want to put it away, you just pull the bottom of it and it goes away like a makeup brush. This is great. This is great for stylists for like retail wise. A lot of our clients buy it because they keep it in their purse.
Well, that's the thing too. Once a client sees something like this that's so different, they're engaged. Yeah. I mean, this must be so easy to retail behind the chair, because once people see it, it's like when they see something they haven't seen a lot of, it always gets them excited. Okay, so what's that?
How you doing, Mikaela?
We've got our third product coming in.
A little invisible serum. That's just to piece out this little fringe in this bottom area. I'm not going to put it anywhere else on the top because I like that kind of
matte. So just around the edges.
Just around the edges to kind of just grip some of this stuff together.
Awesome.
Yeah, but if you could see this now, like if you guys kind of checked, let me dust her off a little bit real fast.
Let's take this cape off and see the beautiful end result. You ready?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Ta-da! Fantastic. Brilliant work from our friend Sal Misseri. Congratulations on all your success.
Thank you.
Congratulations. I hope you're going to be nominated this year. I really think you will, and I'd love to see you win.
Fingers crossed.
And thank you, Davina's, for hosting us in this wonderful space and making this possible for us to share this great education. Thanks, everyone, for watching. Peace.